I'm feeling like a breakthrough is coming. I can't see. Yeah, a breakthrough is coming.
All right, good morning, everybody. How we doing? Good. We're glad to have you here and glad that you've come to join us. And as you can see, we're talking about breakthrough. Breakthrough is our subject for this month, for this series, and I just believe for this year, that this whole year is a breakthrough year, that 2017 is a breakthrough year, that you are going to experience things that you have not experienced before, that you're going to overcome things that have plagued you, that have bothered you, that have kept you stuck and held back, and this year is going to be the year that you're going to break through all of that, and I believe that. I just believe that God has called us to a very specific place. That he's called us to a very specific juncture, if you will, and fork in the road, or I don't know exactly how to put it into words, but I just believe that God has put us in a place where we get to make a decision. Where we get to make a decision: am I going to walk by faith or am I going to walk by fear? Am I going to walk? Let me put it this way. Am I going to walk the way I've always walked, or am I going to walk in the new way that God is calling me? Because you may say, well, I've walked it by faith. Well, then I believe there's more. I believe that there is more for you to walk in. I believe there's more for you to experience. I believe that there's more that you are supposed to lean into and to be a part of than ever before. If you're satisfied with where you are, then I hope that this series is like a stick jabbing you in the ribs and causing you to reach out for more. Because because we live in a world that is so full of things that we don't want, stuff that we don't like, things that hurt, things that create pain, things that cause us emotions that we don't want to feel. And it's in that context, it's in that world that I believe that God has put us to be like a diamond laying on a black velvet piece of cloth. When you go into a jeweler, you don't, they take out a diamond, they take out a diamond ring or something to show you, and they don't just put it on the clear glass, because there's very little contrast there. They pull out this black piece of cloth, this black piece of velvet, and they lay this clear diamond on the black velvet. Why? Because it creates extreme contrast. That's what I believe Christians are to be in the world. Christians are to be in the world what the diamond is to the black velvet. We are to be extreme contrast to the world around us. And if we just bleed into the world around us and there's very little contrast, then we really need to question where we are. We really need to question how we're living and what we're living for and what we're doing with our lives and what we're doing with the calling that God has put into us, because there needs to be contrast. That contrast comes... That contrast can come in a couple of different ways, right? You ever been in a group where there's just that guy, you know, that one person? We call him a jerk or a knucklehead. pain in the rear. I don't know. I'm sure you have some other names you might want to call them. They create some contrast, right? They stand out from the group. They stand out from the rest. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm not telling us to be jerks for Jesus, okay? I'm not saying that is what we are supposed to do to create contrast, because that's the way the world creates contrast. The way we create contrast in the kingdom is by shining in a dark place, is by bringing hope where there is hopelessness, is by bringing love where there is only hatred, is by bringing whatever it is that God has put into you, whatever gift it is that God has put into you, whatever hope that you have, whatever faith that you have, you bring it into a place where all of that is missing. And when you bring it into that place, you will shine like that diamond on the black contrast. We are to be a light on the hill, a city on the hill that shines in the darkness. We're to bring value into the places that God calls us to in life. And when we do that, when we commit ourselves to that, when we surrender ourselves to that, that's when we get to be the one who brings heaven to earth. That's what we're going to talk about today as we talk about this idea of breakthrough. But before we get to that, I just want to read our declaration together. Can we do that? Because this is a good reminder. You need to be reminded. We all need to be reminded. I hope some of you are really taking this seriously and reading it to yourself throughout the week as you go through your day. Here it is on the screen, or you might have your little card with you, but let's read it together. Ready? Here we go. I declare that this is my year of breakthrough. Through God's power in my life, I am overcoming obstacles and breaking down strongholds that have held me back. I am seeing miracles, signs, and wonders around me every day as I walk in the power of the Holy Spirit. I am living in victory over challenges in my life. My God is supplying all I need according to His riches in glory. I am walking in great favor with God as I live my life to bring glory to His name. I am reaching my goals and fulfilling my callings. I am led by Jesus as I lead others to Him. I am spiritually, emotionally, physically, financially, and relationally healthy because I am a child of the King. This is my year of breakthrough. Amen? That's what I believe. That's what we have to lean into. That's the goal. That's the desire. If there's any part of that that just kind of catches you when you read it and you're like, I don't know, I'm not there yet. Well, then that's the part that we need to work on. That's the part that we're going to lean into for you and make sure that by the time this year is over, here's what I believe. If you will lean into this, if you will just allow this to become truth in your life, then I believe that by the time this year is over, all of this will be true of you. So today we're going to talk about calling heaven to earth. Calling heaven to earth. Calling that which is out there into here. One of the challenges, I think, that we can run into, I don't know about you, but I grew up in church most of my younger life. there was a good span in the middle where I did the prodigal son thing and then came back. But there was a lot of foundation built in me early on. Good things and some things I've had to overcome. And one of those things that I've had to overcome that I think was put into me early on was this idea that the world is just bad, all bad, all the time, only bad, and getting worse, and it has to get worse before it can get better. And so why try to make it any better? Because really the goal is to let it get worse so we can get it over with. Anybody else ever grow up in any of that kind of theology? I don't know. Hopefully it was just me, and I don't, you know, might have just been one little pocket and one little tiny church in the mountains of Tennessee. I don't know. I'm pretty sure it's not, because I can show you that theology everywhere. The problem with that theology is it ignores huge principles that Jesus calls us to. It ignores things that the Bible says over and over and over and over again. And here's what I believe. If we can take our pessimistic earthly glasses off and put our heavenly glasses on for just a minute and actually look at the reality of what's happening. The human race is in a better situation, in a better position than it's ever been in the history of mankind. The lifespan, the life expectancy of the human, of men and women on the earth right now is higher than it's ever been in the history of mankind. We live in situations and circumstances, and we have things at our fingertips that make our lives, the quality of our lives, so much better that just 100 years ago, kings and queens and millionaires could not even think of having. We turn a little dial and our houses warm up. We turn it the other way and our houses cool down. We get in our car and we're able to go places that would have taken weeks, now takes hours. We're able to jump on airplanes and get anywhere in the world in a matter of hours. And still yet, there is this pervasive voice that tries to tell us, oh, it's all bad and it's just getting worse. It's all bad and it's just getting worse. And we can buy into that way of thinking. We can buy into that attitude. And what that attitude will do is it will prevent us from actually living into the calling that Jesus wants us to live into. And that calling is this. I believe that we're called to live as Jesus did, the normal Christian life. The normal Christian life is to live as Jesus did by calling heaven to earth. Now, we can get into some revelation theology and all of that stuff, and don't get me started. But anyway. Jesus taught us very clearly, when you pray, pray like this: Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. When I read that prayer, and when I hear what it is that Jesus is asking me to ask for, and I believe deeply that Jesus would never ask me to pray for something that I couldn't have. I believe that Jesus would never tell us to ask for something that he is going to withhold from us. As a matter of fact, if he told us to pray for it, then the Bible says that whatever we ask for, that is according to his will. We already have it. We have it already. And so if he tells us to pray for it, and he's saying, this is my will for you, ask for it and you will have it, then what does it really mean to break this down and say, on earth as it is in heaven? What does it look like in heaven that it should look like on the earth? What does heaven have that earth should have? if this is true? I think number one, earth should have worship. Earth should have worship. That's my first point. Worship is the foundation of our prayer lives. When we worship, when we make God the foundation of our lives, we have one of our five tenets of ministry. One of our, I don't even know what to call them. I've called them everything in the world. There are our mission, there are our vision, there are our core values. They're what we do. They're just how we do life. It's how we believe that God has called us here at this church to do life. And the first one is we are building on a foundation of worship. We are building on a foundation of worship. If you build everything on a foundation of worship, then everything is built on a firm foundation. Because the foundation of worship, the worship of God, is the chief, that is the chief calling of all creation. That even the trees in the forest and the wheat in the fields, they wave their hands in worship toward God. This is what we were made for. This is what we were created for. And so when we get a deeper understanding of what worship really is, what worship really means, then, listen, too many of us compartmentalize it to think that worship is the few songs that we do at the beginning of a service. We sing together and that's worship. Now let's move on and do something else. That is not it. That is one small, tiny component of what it means to live a life of worship. That is a primer. That is important, absolutely, but it's not all that there is. Worship means that everything that I do in my life, I do it to declare the worthship of God in my life. That's what worship means, the worthship of something, the deservingness of that thing that I am worshiping. How much is it worth to me? Is God worth enough to me for me to make different decisions with how I live my life? Is God worth enough to me for me to obey his word and do what he's called me to do? Is God worth enough to me for me to treat another person differently because that's the way God told me to treat them rather than the way I want to treat them sometimes? How much is he worth to you? And when we do that, then we get to live a life that is declaring the worthship of God in our lives. And it will change everything. It will change your marriage. It will change the way you go to church. It will change the way you go to work. It will change the way you go to school. It will change the way you do everything in your life, the way you spend your money and the language that comes out of your mouth and the thoughts that go through your head. It will change everything when you decide that you are going to live a life that declares the worthship of God. And so it requires us to do a little reflection. It requires us to do a little inventory. We live according to the revelation that God has given to us about himself. We live according to what God has revealed to us. And the more revelation that we have, the more this is why studying scripture, this is why gathering together to learn what God has said is so important, because the more revelation, the more enlightenment that we have, the more we understand about him, the bigger he is, the more we can worship him, the more we have to worship about him. God is a good God. We look around at our world and we say, this is a bad world. There's a lot of pain and there's a lot of struggle and there's a lot of hardship and there's a lot of stuff. But listen, I'm telling you, that's what you're seeing with your natural eyes. God is a good God, and that's what we see with the revelation that he's given us. And it's in that goodness that we are to bring, that we are called to worship him. And in worshiping him, we position ourselves to be able to bring heaven to earth, to bring his goodness into the badness, into overlaying. I heard a great example of this one time. If you're a restaurant owner, say you own a restaurant, it's a five-star restaurant, it's like top of the line, everything is pristine in there, it's the best of the best that you can get, and then you go and you buy a gut bomb restaurant right next to you, you know what I'm talking about? Like a, you know, the greasy spoon kind of place. It's just trashed, right? It's awful. You wouldn't even want to eat a hot dog there. It's bad. You bought that place but you own this place. What do you think is going to happen to the gut bomb when a five-star restaurant owner buys it? If he's smart, which he must be if he's got a five-star restaurant, he's going to take those principles, he's going to take that work ethic, and he's going to take all of what he knows about how to build a five-star restaurant, and he's going to overlay it over the gut bomb restaurant. And he's going to start clearing things out, right? He's going to start getting rid of that old, worn out, dirty kitchen equipment and putting new stuff in. He's going to get rid of all that old, beat up, wore out, nasty dining room stuff and get rid and put it new in. He's probably going to replace the staff with some real chefs and some real cooks and some people that care about what they're doing. And he's going to overlay it. And pretty soon, very soon, that place that was not worth, you know, it was a health department violation on steroids, is going to become a five-star restaurant. Because whoever the owner is, whoever the one in charge is, whoever the leader is, that's what they're going to bring to whatever it is that they possess. I guarantee you could probably do it the other way around too. The person that's running the gut bomb could probably take over the five-star restaurant and turn it into a gut bomb. But when God comes into your life, when the kingdom comes into our lives, when the kingdom overlays this mess that we have created for ourselves and this mess that we found ourselves living in when we woke up, when God comes in and overlays the kingdom on that, I'm here to tell you that your gut bomb's about to become a five-star restaurant. That's what it means to bring the kingdom to earth. Jesus begins with worship. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Holy is your name. Lifted high and above all is your name. Listen, this is not to remind God who he is. It's to remind us who we are praying to. It's to remind us that the God that we pray to is high and lifted up, that he is beyond all, that there is no one above him, that there is no one more worthy, and he has called us into his kingdom to be our Father and we to be his children. And we become heirs of that kingdom. We become heirs seated with him, with Christ in heaven already. You say, well, I'm not seated with him in heaven. No, because you're still looking with your earthly eyes. You have to take off those earthly eyes and you have to put on the eyes of faith, where revelation becomes the truth, not what you see with these earth balls, right? I know, it just sounds weird when I say earth balls, but that's what they are. That's all they see. All they see is the earth. All they see is this world that we live in. That's all they can absorb. But I'm telling you to look at it with your heavenly eyes, to look at it through the lens of Scripture, the lens of Scripture that says you have already It's already done. You have already been seated with Christ in heavenly places. What does that mean? That means that I am not stuck here. That I am not stuck in this situation that I'm in. That I'm not stuck in the place. And listen, I know everything in our bodies, in our flesh, in our earthly way of thinking is grating against it and saying, oh no, that's not right. That's not true. I don't know how you get to that. I don't know. It's the grumpy old voice in me. I don't know about you. We're building on a foundation of worship, which means that everything we do has the potential to be worship if you can give it to God and do it for His glory. Everything that you do, if you can give it to God and do it for His glory, it becomes worship. Let me enlighten you to this, though. If you don't feel like you can give it to God and do it for His glory, that's probably what we call sin. That's whatever you can't give to God, like the actions you take, the words you say, the thoughts you have, if you can't give it to God and say this is for your glory, then that ought to reveal something to you. This is sin. I should probably stop doing this. I should probably repent, confess this to God, lay it down at His feet as an offering, and then walk away from it. But when we live in the life of worship, when we experience the worship that God has called us to, where it penetrates and seeps through every area of our lives, that everything that I do unto the glory of God, He will begin to renew my mind. Remember Romans 12? Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Your mind might be thinking, oh, this is no way we can bring heaven to earth. Have you seen how bad this is? Have you seen how horrible this is? Have you seen the pain I've gone through? Have you seen how my life has fallen apart? Have you seen? Yes, I've seen, but I've also seen that there is hope. I've also seen that there is a power above what this world has to offer. I've also seen that God has called me into an eternal life where the temporary problems and pains of this life are paling in comparison to the hope that I have in Christ. And when we begin to live and operate in that way and experience what He has for us, then we can begin to live out this principle: we must bring everything on earth under the dominion of the King. The kingdom is the King's dominion, right? That's what it means. To be in a kingdom is everything that is under that King's dominion. And when we bring anything into the kingdom, it comes under the dominion, the power, the authority of the King. And what God is saying is, when you bring whatever you have under my dominion, under my power, authority, then I take responsibility for it. I take charge of it. And I will and I will make sure that it becomes what I want it to be. So we pray in Matthew 6:10, your kingdom come, your will be done. Your kingdom come, your will be done. What does that mean? Your kingdom come into the earth. Your will be done here on earth as it is in heaven. Your kingdom come. What does that mean? It means that everything in the earth, we are calling for it to come under the dominion of the King. Now, this has to start with you. This has to start with me. We have to begin this process. And so we must bring everything on earth under the dominion of the King. This means, this begins with us and everything that we have influence over. This begins with your life, your thoughts, your actions, your time, your marriage, your family, your job, on and on and on. Anything that you have dominion over, anything that you have influence over, you have to bring it under the dominion of the King, and that becomes a life of worship. Are you following me? Because he is worth more, because he has more, because he has promised more, I want to bring everything that I have under his dominion, under his control, because it's there that I get to bring heaven to earth. Because in heaven, everything is under God's dominion. Everything is under God's control. Here on earth, the only things that are out of control are the things we haven't put under his control. Let's think about that one for a second. The only thing that's out of control in your life right now is the thing that you haven't put under his control yet. What do you need to put under his control? That thing that's causing you the greatest stress and pain and anxiety, that is the thing that needs to be put under his control. That's the thing that we need to lay on the altar and sacrifice to him and say, here, this is this mess. I don't know what to do with it. It's out of control. He says, that's good. I got it. I got it from here. You see, ours is not to fix the problem. Ours is just to simply surrender the problem. To surrender the pain, to surrender the challenge, to surrender what it is, and then to obey the King, to do what he says to do. It's not enough just to bring our mess and then turn around and go make another mess. We bring our mess and then we say, now what do you want me to do, Lord? Now that I've delivered what I did under my control, under my domain, what do you want me to do under your domain, under your kingdom? Because it's there that we will actually begin to make progress and do what God has called us to do and accomplish what God has in store for us to accomplish. This means that my goal is to exchange here. This means that my goal is to exchange my will for God's will in every area of my life. What area of your life do you need to trade your will for God's will, where you need to say, not my will be done, but yours be done, so that it can actually be done in an effective way? What area of your life do you just need to lay on an altar and stab with a knife, or set fire to it, or something to make sure it doesn't get up off the altar? Because it's when we begin to lay it down and leave it that God can take a mess and make a miracle out of it. Number three, we pray to transform the world we see to the world God wants. When we pray to transform the world we see to the world that God wants, we say, on earth as it is in heaven. On earth as it is in heaven. Listen, I hear the voice in my head. I'm sure that it's going off in some of your heads. It can't be on earth the way it is in heaven. Well, if it can't be, then why did Jesus tell us to pray for it? That's my question to my voice. I don't know what argument you want to have in your head, but that's the argument that I have in my head. If it can't be on heaven as it is in earth, then why would Jesus, a loving Savior, tell us to ask for it? But I don't see it anywhere around me. But I don't see the possibility. I don't see how it could ever be. I don't. You're not called to live by sight. You're called to live by faith. If we were called to live by sight, then we could just go according to what we see. But that is not the lifestyle that we have been called to. He called us to a different kind of life. He called us to a life that transcends what we see. I feel it. Do you feel it? Do you feel the pull? Do you feel the tug? Do you feel the opposition against this idea within you that says, no, that's not that. I can't go there with you, preacher. I don't know what. It's not me. I'm just the messenger. I'm just telling you what Jesus said. This is what you ask for. This is what we ask for. We ask for breakthrough that is beyond anything we can ever ask for or imagine. Listen, if you can't ask for it or imagine it, that means that your brain can't go there, but his can. And when I say your will be done on earth as it is in heaven, that means that things that I can't even dream up to ask for or imagine in my head, he already has planned to deliver. I need my mirror. I'm just going to use this reflective thing to talk to, because I just need to talk to me a little bit about this. Do you understand what kind of warfare it requires to live by faith on this planet? To live by faith and to live by the revelation that God has given to us, instead of living according to the way it's always been and what we see with our earth balls, because they will keep you from seeing. They will make you blind. Your eyes will make you blind because you see the problem too clearly. Because you see the challenge, you see the limitation, you see the impossibility. But Jesus himself said, everything is possible for those who believe. Did he lie? But I don't see it. Well, you're looking with the wrong eyeballs. You're using the wrong thing to see. According to what Jesus teaches us to pray, earth is to be a mirror image of heaven where God's will is done. I want you to know, I really struggle with putting this in my notes, and then I really struggled with putting it on the screen. Why? Because this takes you into a whole new level of understanding. This takes you into a whole new level of possibility where we cannot settle for or stand for impossibility. What this really means to me is that if this is true, if this is true, then this must be true. If it doesn't exist in heaven, it should not exist on the earth. Wait a minute. I made a short list of things I could think of that I'm pretty sure do not exist in heaven. Things like death, sickness, disease, pain, suffering, lack, fear, anxiety. These things were not created by God. These things are the normal result, the natural result of sin and our rebellion against God. So what would happen if we reverse the process? By grace, you have been given the opportunity to reverse the process. It was by grace that you have been saved, by no works of your own, that Jesus defeated the enemy on the cross, the one who delivered sin into the world, who, by the way, is the result. The results are death, suffering, sickness, disease, lack, fear. Those things did not exist prior to sin entering the world. Jesus came to defeat sin. So when sin is gone from the world, those things don't exist anymore because they are no longer the natural result. Are you following me? I'm flying at about 60,000 feet right now. I just want you to understand, this is big picture stuff.
This is big picture stuff, but if it doesn't come down to the level, to ground level surface, we will never really get to live the normal Christian life. We will never really get to live the Christian life that Jesus lived. The kind of life that when he walked in, the sick were healed, the dead were raised, the lepers were cleansed, the demons were cast out and could not stand in his presence. We call those miracles. Jesus calls that Tuesday, Thursday afternoon. It was just normal to him that those things happen. Why? Because he had no sin with him. And when he walked into a place, when he brought light in to that level, darkness had to flee. The natural result of sin could not live in his presence. That's the life we are called to live, Christian. That's the life we are called to deliver, demonstrate, and experience here on the earth as it is in heaven. Do you believe that? Do you know how much faith it requires to believe that? Here's another one. If it exists in heaven, then it should exist on earth. This one's a little harder. But here's what I'm pretty sure exists perfectly in heaven. Things like health and power and strength and love and hope and provision for all of our needs. These are the things that are available in heaven. I believe these are the things that are available if we will simply live by faith. I want you to feel how hard I struggle with this. I really do. Because I don't want to seem like a preacher that's just coming in here preaching this big, lofty, kind of faith, do it for God's kind of sermon, and not understand that this is the battle of my life. That this is the struggle that I fight every single day. That in my mind there is a war that rages every day, and it never lets up. And this is what it is, because I know that there is more, and I know that God has called us to more, and I know that if we're not willing to give up our very lives for it in pursuit of it, we are not going to experience it. But Jesus said this: if you will lay down your life for me in this struggle, I will give you life. I will give you a life that you can't even dream of or imagine. That's the life I'm in pursuit of. That's the breakthrough I'm in pursuit of. My God will liberally supply. Fill until full. Your every need according to his riches in glory in Christ Jesus. What is your need today? What is the breakthrough that you're in pursuit of? What is that thing that you just can't see any way around, that you just can't see any possibility, and it's causing you, because it's so big and because it's looming so large, it's causing you to just want to turn around and run away and retreat. I want you to hear this. The world wants to look back with regret. In the kingdom, we look forward with hope and with faith. And not just a faith that is some wishy-washy kind of soft little thing. We look forward with the kind of faith that takes the kingdom with violence. The violent are what are moving forward in the kingdom. Violence can, I realize it can mean a bad thing. It can mean to hurt someone. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about, and I believe that when the Bible talks about this, he's talking about the kind of aggression and the kind of, I don't have a word for it. Whatever the word would be for someone that would be willing to take their fingernails and scratch their way through that wall. Whatever that is, that's what I'm talking about. That's the way we're going to take the kingdom. That's the kind of violence it's going to require for us to take the kingdom. Because everything in us fights against this, doesn't it? Can you feel it? I feel it. I feel it very strong. This is a new way of thinking. I feel like I feel like on one hand I've preached this sermon 100 times. I feel like on the other hand, this is the first time I even thought of anything like this. I believe that the reason why that is because as much as we think into this, as much as we think we understand, as much as we think we know, as far as we think we've gone, we haven't even scratched the surface yet of what God wants to do with us. Can you feel it? Is there anybody with me? I'm feeling awfully alone right now. Is anybody? Thank you for those hands. I appreciate that. I'm feeling like a breakthrough.